Meg, can I see that this is not going to be me just talking, we have to do it together. So you might have suggestions, you might think of ideas that I may not have thought about, so you can just, we talk together, and I would have like a conversation together, like an interactive talk. So, why do we become parents? Why? To bring the new people in this world. Has anybody got anything to add? There's no right or wrong answer. Just wanted to say no.
Because we love children.
Because you love children, okay? And do you... Oh, sorry, I didn't answer. I can hear some aunties saying something. Auntie, that's all. Why do we become parents?
To complete a family.
So maybe if you're husband and wife, then you feel like you need something more. Yeah. Some people might say it's an expression of husband and wife's love. Yeah. As a Sikh, to have children, I know a Guru Sikh, and he said you should have at least 4 children minimum. That's nothing compared to our grandparents, because my grandparents, she had 13 children on both sides. So my nanki and my dadki, they had like 14 on one side, 15 on one side. But that's, you know. This Guru Sikh, he said Sikhs should have a minimum of 4 children, at least one will become a Guru Sikh out of that. Yeah, so. Do you ever think about the kind of parents we want to be?
Sorry?
What type of parents do we want to be?
Good parents, of course.
Good parents. What defines a good parent?
Teaching children the best things.
What's the best things?
Diligence, social life, love each other, love thy neighbor.
Which can listen to their kids?
Panji?
Which can listen to their kids?
Parents who listen to the children.
Listen to the kids.
Anybody else?
Respect.
Respect. Teach the children respect. You want them to be respectful, sorry. Anji, anybody else?
Role models.
Anji?
Friendly with the kids.
Anji?
Role models.
You want your children to be role models? Yeah? Role models for who? I haven't practiced this. I'm having a conversation with you right now. Whatever. I've asked Guru Sahib when I did my Adar, so I said, with your blessings, I invoke you to come inside me. Whatever conversation you want to have with the Sangha, let's do it. Yeah, so this is not me talking, this is us together with Guru Sahib. So, so you said, role models for who, Mikey?
Society.
Okay, so you want society to see your children and feel that they could be possible a role model. When I do this, then you change it. Okay, so you've kind of answered that question as well, thank you. Okay. So what do we want for our children? So I was thinking about myself when I was putting this talk together and having a think, and I was thinking about to be a good parent or for this talk to be successful, what are the key things? And one of the things that I was thinking to myself was what do we want for our children? So can anybody just again, a good future. What do you define as a good future?
Teach them for Sikhi as well as education.
Okay, education.
Mm-hmm. We want our kids to become a good human being. First.
A good human being. Okay. Anybody else?
Good citizen. Being respectful to others.
Hanji?
Helpful to others.
Helpful to others.
Give respect to others.
Yeah. Anybody else? Keep going. From a Punjabi perspective, I wasn't born and raised as a Gursikh, like, I wasn't raised like this. I come from a Punjabi background, which is very different from a Sikhi background. So I was thinking to myself, if I was a Punjabi parent, and I was asked that question, what would be the first things that come into my mind? So, okay, Ankiti, Pasikiasi, Sikhi, you want your children to come to Sikhi, that's fine. But if you wasn't sitting in the Gurdwara today and someone asked you that question, would Sikhi been the first answer you would have said? Maybe not. Maybe yes, maybe not. But as a Punjabi, most parents, these are the things that I thought that they would come up with. The first thing would be health. They want their children to be healthy. Successful career, so they would want them to have a very good higher education. They want them to be externally attractive. They want their children to look good. And they want them to be marriage material, a good prospect as a marriage for the future. Does everybody agree with that? Yeah? So if we think about the people around us, maybe our family or our friends, when you're watching them raise their children, you probably see them putting effort into all these things, but how much effort do you see them putting into raising a spiritual child? Not much. You wouldn't see that, yeah? You don't see that, okay. Fine. I thought I might get a bit of, no, that's not true, but you've agreed with me. It's rare. It's not completely not there, but it's rare that you would find the parents that are trying to create all these things that you've mentioned, so good human being, love thy neighbour, respectful, but then the spiritual aspect is not given to the child, yeah? Most Punjabis are atheists. They don't know it, but they are atheists. They don't actually believe in God because they don't know about God. They come to the Gurdwara and they do this ritual of doing Mata Day, but they don't really know what's there. Myself being one of them once, yeah? So let's look at this more in detail. So how do we implement these things? So I was thinking to myself, looking around my daya, my jajje, my cousins, how did these things implemented? So with health, I started to think to myself, well, how are these things implemented and are they implemented? So we want all these things, but do we actually go to the effort to infusing these things into our children's lives? My answer is no. Because if we want our children to be healthy, we train our children from a very, very young age that if they do something good, I'm going to treat you to a happy meal. Yeah? Because it's seen as a treat. But if we wanted to be really, really good parents and wanted to have really healthy children and we were to look into what our children are eating, we would know that giving a child a happy meal is actually very, very bad for them. Yeah? Do we encourage our children to do exercise? Do we train them to even the smallest exercise, maybe yoga, even cleaning their room, even helping around the house? Do we encourage our children to do that? That's a form of exercise, but we don't. Yeah, we're happy to just put them in front of an iPad and expect them to, you know, we monocoddle our children to a point that is when we're going to want alone time, we're never ever going to get that alone time because the child wants to be with the mother all the time or the father. So are we really raising healthy children? Yeah. What are we surrounding our children around when it comes to health? Everybody in this room knows one alcoholic in their family or friend, yeah? In the Punjabi community now. Our children are surrounded by that. For me, when I was growing up, to drink alcohol was very normal. There was nothing wrong with it, yeah? It was even in my adult years, there was nothing wrong with it. It was only when my chacha, who was an alcoholic, he died of it. He actually collapsed in the middle of a road of it. And still to this day, I mean, the end of his life was very, very traumatic for me and our family. It was very, very bad how he died from the alcohol. But still, everybody in my family still drinks. I'm the only one who stopped. Because no one is conscious to, everybody has the attitude, that will never happen to me. Or no one wants to make the stand that that's a bad thing, so I don't want to do that for my children. I'm going to give you an example. My cousin, she phoned me last night. She was married to a black guy, and she's got two mixed race children. And she actually divorced her husband because she really wanted to come this way her children were raised Catholic, but she wanted to learn about Sikhi. She was listening to Bart in the car, and she started wearing Punjabi suits, and he didn't like that. And they just got a divorce. So this is somebody who has not had much exposure to Sikhi at all. And during her divorce, she started drinking quite a lot. very much. She started drinking, she started doing shots and things like that. And one day her daughter, she's 14 years old, her daughter said to her, "You drunk again, Mum?" And her, she said, this is someone who's conscious to what she's exposing her child to. Yeah? She said, she goes, "My home name is Rupi." She said, "Rupi, from that day, I realised, what am I doing?" But she goes, "I still didn't stop." Carried on. And she said, until her son, who's I think he's 11 or something, he said, "Mum, I want to do shots of Coke." So she was doing shots of tequila, but he said, "I want to do shots of Coke." Yeah? And she realised he's learning that from her. And he wants to do it with Coke, he doesn't want to do it. But she realised that she was setting that bad example and she stopped drinking straight away, then and there. How many Punjabis would do that? Would see their child mimicking what they're doing and then go, "I don't want to do that anymore. This is not promoting a very healthy lifestyle for my child, therefore I don't want to make them think that this is normal." Because alcohol now is very normal for Punjabis, but it's not meant to be. For Sikhs, Punjabis, but for Punjabis, Sikhi, the alcohol is like what it is for Muslims. It's forbidden. You know, we're not meant to do that. Yeah, we shouldn't even be around that. And that was just a point I wanted to make on health. There's many other things that we can talk about. We can talk about meat. We can talk about, you know, harming animals and encouraging our children to eat meat and things like that. But you say you want your children to be respectful, yeah? But you just want them to be respectful of humans. We don't want our children to be respectful of animals then. Animals, their lives don't mean anything. God still protects them. You know, so you have to think about what decisions that I'm making. Sikhi's not easy. Sikhi's really, really hard to be a parent. I was saying to Benji when we were on our way here, I said, to be a parent is hard enough. To be a Sikh parent is even harder because you have to be conscious about every little thing that we do. Every decision that we make has to come back to Kursa in every kind of way. So even I don't even take my daughter to the zoo because I say to her, we can't go to the zoo because we're saying to the people who keep the animals trapped, that's okay. Because I've looked into how the conditions that the animals are kept in the zoo. They're not fed on time, they're not looked after very well. Some places are, most places are not. So I don't want to encourage her to think that that's okay, to treat animals that way. There's people looking at me like, I never thought of that before. And it's true, because you know, a couple of years ago, I wouldn't have thought about these things before, but it's just something to think about. We just need to be sure. So we want our children to have a successful career. Can you just pass me my phone for 1 second? It's just there, yeah. Thank you. I'm not taking any calls or anything, it's just something I want to read out to them. We want our children to have successful careers, which means that they need to have very high education, they need to be good in their education. Yeah? We want all these things. Yeah. And so there's two ways to look at this in my own mind. Maybe you have another way. I was thinking to myself, there's a type of parent that's so desperate for their child to be highly educated, become doctors, accountants, this and that, have their own business, become entrepreneurs, that they hire tutor upon tutor, put them in different groups, different kind of classes and advanced classes and extra curriculum kind of activities they put their child in to make their push their child to become really, really good in their careers. But they don't even send them to one Santhiya class to learn about Gurbani or Punjabi class or Gatka class to teach them about the spiritual side. Or there's the types of parents that say, they say all these things and they hire all these tutors and things like that, but they don't spend one night with them next to their bed reading to them at night, themselves. Yeah? So how can we measure whether our children are being successful in their careers or in their sikhi or anything if we're not actually spending time with our children, we're hiring someone to do it? Because it's very easy to do it now. But what the child will get when you sit next to your child and you're reading with them is something that child will never ever forget, I guarantee you. When I was young, my mum used to sit at the end of the bed with me and she used to recite Mool Mantra, and I used to repeat after her. I still have that in my mind that she used to do that. I was so young. I've got a very bad memory, but that's something that I always remember. It's something that you're giving your child that child will never ever forget. But do we take the time to do that? Now I need to do the cleaning. Now I need to watch my soaps. Now I need to watch this. I need to go here. Yeah, I need to make the... We always make excuses. Yeah, but when we're pregnant, we're thinking to ourselves, when I have my child, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to make sure my child is like this. But then we get caught up in life, or we get caught up in society and what society wants, and we don't do all those things. So when it comes to wanting our children to be successful, having successful careers, I'm not saying don't hire tutors, very good, hire tutors, but think to yourself about how much time I'm putting in with my child and that child's education. Yeah. It cost me £12 from Waterstones, but I went and bought the SATs level 2 for my daughter the other day, and we sat and we did it that night, we did it in, after dinner. And it took me probably half an hour, but she loved it. Even though she was doing work, she didn't feel like she was doing work, she thought she was spending time with her mum. Yeah, which is so important, and it's actually lost now. It's completely lost. We don't spend any time with our children now. Does anybody have anything to add on that? There's probably lots that we could say about that. Thank you.
That's the most important thing you can do for children, with your time you're investing in them.
Thank you.
Once it's gone, it's gone.
That's true. Because another thing about when you give your child, because we want all these things for our child, but then how do we measure that what we want for our child, how do we measure that we're succeeding at that? We can't. If we're not spending time with the child, you don't know. So if I wanted my child to be really good at like a bath or something, if I'm not spending time with the child, how will I ever know that she's excelled to the next 40 or she's gone to the next level? So I will never know because I'm not spending time with that child. Another thing that happens is when we don't spend time with our children, we don't know what they're up to. We don't know what their mindset has become. We don't know what they're being exposed to. But just through having conversations with our children, we know what's happening around them, what people are saying to them in school, what influences are having on them. Yes?
Yes, could I add on something? If you've spent time with your child, from a personal experience, I think child is more content.
Anji.
And is more friendly with the parents.
Anji.
Anything happens in the school, anywhere, he will tell first to the parents. You don't have to find out from the friends or somebody.
It's true.
And they never ask for things. You get them something, they are happy because they are getting time from the parents.
Yeah. I don't know if that's always true.
Mine was, anyway.
You don't spend all the time, but she still wants to go to build a bed.
No, mine always consider like his cousins, they used to have all the Xbox. This, as soon as they come, they used to have it. Mine never asked. Because once we mentioned, I said, look, he's staying home by himself. His mom is working, but your mom is home when you are home. So he's always content. He never asked for it.
That's good. Yeah, so time is really important. External attraction. We always want our children to be attractive to other people. We want people to come up to us and say, that I'm going to board smarter. Yeah? And the only way that our child looks smart is that when they're born, the first thing we don't do is go and cut their hair. we're going to cut their hair, or when the girl gets a certain age, we're going to take her to go and get her eyebrows done. And we don't teach our children about internal attraction, beauty. We teach them about external. So I know everybody said we want our children to be respectful, we want them to be this, we want them to be that. Those things are all internal things that we have to teach our children. But we actually, if you think about it, focus more on them be the outside being attractive more than the internal. You know? So I'll give you an example. The other day, my daughter, the teacher, came up to me when I went to pick her up, and she said, there's been an incident, but it's under control. I said, because they know that I'm very, very much always working with the I want to know all the things that happen with my daughter's daily school life. I'm always talking to them. They know they can't get away with anything with me because I want to know what's happening. So she said, but it's under control. Someone said to her today, you can't play with us because you're not black. I've never ever taught my child that about being black, Chinese, anything. I always show her picture of Gore Sikh, Chinese Sikh, Gala Sikh. I always tell her we are all the same. Yeah, it doesn't matter what colour we are, because it doesn't matter. I shielded her from these things. So when someone said that to her, she didn't understand it. Hanji, did you want to say something, Auntie Jean?
To me?
Hanji?
No.
Oh, okay. And so I said, what did she do? My daughter is very, very weak. I say weak. When I say weak, I mean she doesn't stand up for herself.
Soft.
very soft, right? And I said, okay, what happened? And she said, she went and pushed the boy. She pushed the boy. I was in shock. I said, I'm going to have a word with her about that, because I didn't know that. I never teach her to hit anybody, never teach her to hurt anybody. Even if someone hurts her, I said, don't do it. Unless you feel you are in really grave danger, then you do whatever you've been taught. And she said, I did it because this is what he said to me. That the way I explained it to her was, I said, there's a Gordian knot called Daisy. I said, if I was to cut Daisy's hand open, what colour would come out? She said, red blood. I said, if I ate the gala, what Colin is then? I said, if I was to cut Colin's hand, what colour would come out? She said, blood, red blood. I said, if I cut your hand, what colour? She said, red blood. I said, doesn't that mean that they're all the same? She said, yes. And I said, they have been taught that because you look different on the outside, that we are different. But what really matters is that inside we are the same. And that's what Guruji, because inside Guruji's there. And that's all that should matter. Then she was like, okay, mummy, it's because they don't know, or their mummies haven't taught them. I said, yeah, that's right. I said, but this is what we believe, this is how we think. And she was fine, she confronted him the next day. She said, can you come over to our house and play? You know, children, they forget these things. They're not like us holding grudges forever. And so what we need to ask ourselves is, how are we going to teach our children how to be internally attractive? To be so beautiful in the inside that people will see the beauty on the outside anyway, yeah? So the people look at the Dali girls and they're like, oh, she ain't done her eyebrows, or she wears the scars, oh, she's got a Dali, she's got this, she's got that. But you don't know anything about that person. You don't know inside what she's like. She might be willing to die for you, or he might be willing to die for you tomorrow, yeah? But there might be someone who's very beautiful on the outside, and they are not very nice people. And you probably will find that a lot more in people, yes? That happens. Or we look at someone who may be disabled or something like that, and we think to ourselves, oh, they can't do this, they can't do that, I'm better than them. Yeah, externally they don't look the way we look, so therefore there must be something wrong with them. So we need to be conscious about these things, because whatever we think, our child, we will infuse that into the child. So we need to be aware of these things. And then we want our children to be marriage material, which puts all of this all together, and then that's what we create. So we make them really good looking, we make them have a high education, and then we find a really, really good match for them, and then we do their lama, or you know, if they have a lama or whatever, and then they get married, and then they go on to have children, and then what do they give their children? So the cycle repeats itself. If we're not conscious to it and we don't start stopping it now, we save our poor's corner, we don't start teaching our, bringing these, sowing the seed and bringing these things to Bibi's attention now, we need to stop what's happening, yeah, in terms of we're raising children that are not conscious to society, to spiritual life, to all these kinds of things. You can press all. So how can I make my children follow Sikhi? Now, there's no book, a parenting for dummies. I've said that before, because it's not easy being a parent. Not all rules apply to same, or not all every rule or every kind of implementation will apply to every child, because every child is different. Only you know how you can push your child and in what direction. But these are just some ideas that I'm giving you as an individual. So if anyone doesn't like what I'm saying, it's nothing to do with Cause Corner. No need to blame them, blame me. Yeah, but these are things that I do. So how can I make my child follow Sikhi? So the first thing is, a Guru Sikh in commentary told me, when I asked the child, how can I make my child not fall in love with sleep? Because sleep is very dangerous. We're meant to get up very early in the morning, and I find it very hard to get up early in the morning. So I was asking the question in terms of, I want to train my child, can I train my child now to start to get up early in the morning, so that when they become, or if they become Gursikh, that their Amritvela is strong, basically. And the Gursikh said, first of all, a child at a young age, I was very young when I asked the question, the Gursikh said, first of all, a young age child needs good sleep. Yeah, because that's when their cognitive, the everything in their mind is kind of like working itself out, and you know that's when their brain is developing, and their body's healing as well when sleep heals. So they need good sleep. But he, what he said is that you can create a mechanical Sikhi. You can make everything mechanical for your child. So they have set times that they do things. So when they go to eat their food, we should teach them a small part that teaches them how to be thankful for their food. So they're thanking Guruji for the food. That's the first thing. When you get in the car, there should be a, we do Aad Gurinamme, Jugaad Gurinamme, Sat Gurinamme, Siri Gurudevinamme, Vayudji Gakasa, Vayudji Gakasa. It's just small, it's little, but my daughter, she's trained that she has to do that before the car starts. When we do our gears, when we comb our gears, which she hates to do because she's got very, very long, heavy hair, basically she knows that she has to do Vayudji Simran to try and help her to stop crying from the Akta coming out. Yeah, even though, and I'll say to her, you're not doing your Vayudji Simran, she's like, oh my God, you shouldn't be doing that. But she knows that she has to do that, yeah. And what else do we do? At bedtime, she can have one English book from school that she can read, but she has to do five before she goes to bed, and she has a gutka by her bed. So she does her bath before she goes to bed, and then she can, then after she's done her bath, then she can read whatever she likes, yeah. And if she wants to watch a movie in the day, she has to watch a Sikhi movie. Yeah? And there's, so these are like the mechanical things that we've taught her. Very, very mechanical. When she comes to the Gurdwara, we've taught her that you do Matadek, and then you do Parkarma, and then you do Matadek, and then you get Prashad, and then you sit down. Yeah? And then it's not just, when I say mechanical, I don't just tell her that that's what you do and that's it, you're doing it, which is what my parents done to me. Not that they come to do Prakarma, but I used to come to the Gurdwara, I had no idea what I was doing in the Gurdwara. We taught her little things. So every time we would go to the Gurdwara, little bit by little bit, from when she was very young, and with children, you have to repeat yourself over and over again. So the amount of times I told her, this is a Jindua, and this is where Guru Sahib sits. Underneath there's pillows, then this is the Golak, and this is the Jorsar, teaching her these things, what these things are and why they're there. Otherwise the child will grow up to become, what I think is what's happening, is we're becoming atheists because we don't know about these things. Everything's become like a ritual, we just come and do it and we go. But no one really knows. So even when we go to programs and someone maybe is, you know, they give the Sarapa, to the whoever's birthday or something it is, I always explain to her, if someone's doing something wrong, I'll explain it to her. So people, they get up to go and get their sarapa and they don't wash their hands. I always say that's wrong, that person should wash their hands. If you ever get one, you go and wash your hands first. Doesn't matter how long the sangha is waiting, you wash your hands first, you go down, do matadek to Guru Sahib, then you go on your knees, yeah? And this is why we do it, because it's a gift from God. Explaining every little thing, tiny, tiny little detail, explaining it to the child. Put your hands up if you do that. I know, I'm not saying, oh, you're wrong or bad, but because you might not know, so now you know. But this is something that I've learned that I've had to do with my child, because if someone asks, we want our child to be a role model, we want our child to be a role model to the world, but what happens if you're sitting in a wedding and someone's invited a gora to the nun code, and they just happen to be sitting next to your child and they say, what are they doing that for? And your child doesn't know. That child is not able to be a role model for Sikhi. What I do is I make everything about Sikhi. Everything in my child's life, I bring it back to Sikhi. Everything. Ask me anything. Even if it doesn't make sense to her, I do it. Because I'm trying to remind her about Guru all the time and myself. So ask me anything. Give me an example. And then I'll try and bring it back to Sikhi. Go on, I'll see if I can do it on the spot. Anything?
Teaching her to eat better.
Teaching her to eat better?
Yeah.
How would I do that? I don't actually have that problem because my child eats all the time. I didn't even wash her cup one day yet. She wasn't ready for the next meal.
Exercise.
How to do exercise. I say, Guru Angad Dev Ji said, Guru Angad Dev Ji was a wrestler. Mm-hmm. Which means that he's setting the example that we must be fit. Yeah? Guru Nanak Dev Ji walked everywhere when he did his Udasana. Which means that we should be fit, she says. After having two samosa downstairs. how to eat better, I'd probably say to her something like, you know, well, actually, with that, I would always say, I'll give her some prasad afterwards. Or with my daughter, what I do with her is we make prasad at home. I'm not very good at it, but, you know, it comes out really, really bitty, but I try. And she loves to cook. So what I say to her is, if you eat, then, you know, I would say that to her if I had that problem, which I'm having with my 10-month-old, because she doesn't like to eat. But I would probably say something like that to her. Or we can make some goodie cupcakes afterwards, you know, or something like that, and put like egg on gar on there, something like that, icing. To encourage the child, I'm still trying to stay in there. So like recently my child has lost all her teeth. Oh my God, I really miss those milk teeth, they're so sweet. So what I do is she must have, one of the teeth come out in school and her teacher said, put it under your pillow and the fairy will come and give you money or give you something. I said, we don't have fairies, we've got shehitsings. The shehitsings will come, they'll give you something and they'll take your teeth away. Yeah, so that's how I do it. We don't have fairies, although I do believe in fairies. Well, I say, Kumasab said, talk to that fairy, but I mean, you know what I mean. But I said to her, shehitsings will come and take your teeth. And then we go and buy her something nice. Because, you know, I could, you know, so, and then, so she got like the last week or something, her tooth come out, and we got her like a minion book, because she loves minions. And she woke up in the morning and ran to my room and said, Mummy, she eats sing. But I don't think it was the sing, I think it was Sundari. She loves Sundari, the movie. She said, I think it was Sundari. She's the one who left me a minion book and took my tooth. I'm trying to get my child excited about Sikhi. I'm making it fun for them. I'm not making it a chore. What else can I think about? What else? Benj, can you think of anything that I do for my Simra? I think my head's going blank or something. When we do camps and things like that, we try and do fun things. Like we teach the children about, we do, you know, we teach about what hazuria is, like by South Wayne, the white hazuria. And then we just get the kids to decorate it afterwards. We get cut little pieces for them and then we get them to decorate it. And what happens is that the child starts to think about what they've just been taught while they're doing it, while they're in contact with this thing. Because does anybody know what the hazuria is? I'm not going to talk about what the hazuria is. Yeah. But put your hands up if you know what the hazuria is. It's such a basic thing, but we don't know. Yeah. What the purpose is for it? That's what I mean. But we don't know about these very. I'm just using that as an example. But there's like all these things that as parents we don't even know. Do you see where I'm going with this, yeah? So I try and make everything about Sikhi. And also, I reward my child a lot. I reward my daughter quite a lot. Basically, when she learns something new in Sikhi, I'll reward her. Doesn't mean that I buy her anything expensive, it might just be a Kinder surprise. But I want her to feel like when she learns something, and I always tell her, oh, when it's her birthday, she always gets a card from the Gurbanji. And good organ seems to write a little shovel in there or something like that, where she, in her mind, because she's becoming older now, so she knows that we are doing it. But from a very, very young age, she's always been very aware of good organ seems to be giving her a card. It's a small thing, a small gesture.
In the Brook of Vengeance, there's two things to it. One was regarding the fairy. Jotsu asked me the same question. She said, Mommy, do Sikh believe in fairies? I said, good on. But if all the gods are Guru Gobind Singh Ji's fairies, they're princes, they're better than fairies. And if you try what Guru Gobind Singh Ji asked us to do and just follow everything, you can be more better than the fairies.
Yeah.
And the same question we asked in the class, and her answer was the same. It was a coincidence. She asked me like 3 days ago, answered back. And they are obviously teacher asking that class, and it was the same answer. And regarding what you do, the one thing I like, the tattoo, the similar one, you put it on Facebook.
Say that again?
The what you do with your kids, the most thing I like, Manchinam has a little tattoo, and she was doing the Simran.
Oh yeah.
So that was...
Oh yeah. I don't know if you've heard of a company called Build-A-Bear. My daughter is obsessed with this company, Build-A-Bear. She's gone there today with her dad, who's 12. She's got so many Build-A-Bears, but she, what we don't, from when she was young, actually, this wasn't actually me, this was my sister. My sister's not into Sikhi at all. When she was a baby, my sister went and got her the bear, and my sister recorded Waigu, 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 Waigu on the bear. I don't know if anybody's, you can record any sound inside the bear. And so when she got to an age where we took her again, then she said, I wanted to record vocals in the mom there. So she recorded, so she's got so many that all got vocals in the mom. When I had my baby now, then when Simba said to me, my 6-year-old, she said, I want to get one for her. We need to have vocals in on that one too. So it's like, it's an English toy, but it's got something Sikhi element to it. Another thing we do is, when she has a toy, she loves to put the star on her toys, or her dollies. Because we've taught her that that's a natural form of what we should look like, have the star, like our guru. Then we've got loads of games that we play. So like basically, we change games. So like, you know, you have Duck Duck Goose, yeah? We change it to Waibu Sathanam. So basically, instead of saying duck, 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 goose, we say waiguru, 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 satana, and then you have to run. So we try and change these things to make it more Sikhi. You can probably think of loads of other games. You know, you have like bingo, we play Sikhi bingo. So they'll have like a Sikhi word and things like that. It's on, what we done was we laminated it. And so it's got Sikhi words on there, and then when we pick out the word, and then the word comes out, Gis, or Gagar, Guru Gobind Singh Ji, whoever gets it first time, I say, Vaiguru, instead of bingo. So kids will love it. Your children will love it, your grandchildren will love it. You just have to think, try and make yourself think everything Sikhi.
We do Vaiguru I Spy in the
car. Oh, yeah.
So we do say, we bet at the beginning, we say it has to be a Sikhi word, like,
yeah, that's a good one. One we do in the car when we're stuck in traffic and she's driving me crazy is we say to her, you have to do the whole of the alphabet, but you're only allowed to think of Sikhi words, and you can't repeat a word. So she might say Anand, you say Baba Buddha Ji, and she says Jumdoa. Next one, yeah, and then on and on and on and on. And then she starts to find it really hard till she gets to the end and things like that. But it's just about kind of, you could play any game with them. You could put Kiss FM on or the radio on, but what are they going to get away from it? What are they going to get out of that? What positivity are they going to get out of that apart from songs about somebody or, you know, something sexual or something like that, yeah? So you need to think, what am I exposing my child to? What am I exposing my child to? We want our children to be healthy, but then why are we surrounding them around like people who are drunk? You know, we want our children to be good people. We want them to be respectful people, but are we gossiping around our children? Because then they're going to think that's normal. You know, and then Sangha. Whenever there's a camp, I try and take her if I can. Whenever we go to the Gurdwara, Sangha with Guruji, Sangha with people her own age who look like her. She wears a dastar or she wears a patka in the day. So people who look like her, so she doesn't feel. So when she goes to school and people say things to her, and they do say things to her about the way she looks because she wears a patka and she's a girl, people do say things to her. But it doesn't, Guruji's Gurdwara, it doesn't actually really affect her. Because whenever she's not in school, I take her and put her in places where people look like her. So she knows that's the normal. But if we don't do that, then she's always going to be surrounded by people that don't look like her, and she's going to think that's normal. So that means mummy doesn't get spa days. I was taken to Benji, I really need some alone time. But mummy doesn't get time for herself. I don't even have time to go to the gym now, because I've got two now. But this is more important to me. This is more important to me, my child. I'm setting that foundation for her. And family time is included in Sangha. So, you know, we play games at home. We'll have movie night. So, there's so many Sikhi movies out there now. Jar Sahib Zadeh, Sundari, Bhai Taru Singh, Bhai Shabashin, Bhai Shabir Singh. All these movies, Banda Singh Bahadur, movie night, popcorn. We've got loads of junk food there. And we sit there with our feet up, and she loves it. Yeah. And we're just doing that for her. We've seen it 100 times. I could be cleaning the kitchen, I could be doing 100 other things that I've left at home right now even. But I'm thinking to myself, this is more important. I sit down with her and watch it. And she's excited about it. She's seen it so many times and she's still excited about it. When Charles Tavazella came out, we took her to watch that 4 times. Because she had so much inside her that she wanted to see that. And I wanted to keep that flame alive for her. And why shouldn't I? I would take her in 2 seconds to go and see an English movie, so why shouldn't I take her, spend the money, at least the money goes to making, you know, something positive. Okay, so what are the best ways to teach my child about Sikhi? So things that I do is we do bedtime Sikhi time. We sit down with her and she can read any story she likes, English, but she always has to have a Sikhi story, which is a Sikhi. Real life story about our gurus and our... even I talk to her about stories of 1984 now. She wants to know about these things. She wants to know what's happened to the Sikhs. And it provokes her to ask questions. Mommy, if I went to India, would the bad people try and kill me because I wear the scarf? I know you may look at me now for just sort of and go, that's really bad that a child would say that. It's not. My child should know what's happened in her history. She should know. She should know that that we don't have a sovereignty, we don't have a country, that you know, our people are fighting for a country, land. We're fighting for equality in India, that we don't have it. I want her to know that. I want her to question these things. When she questions these things, then I can kind of control her thinking. If she doesn't question me and she goes and asks the wrong person, yeah, that's very dangerous. If your child was coming up, there's some people that I've spoken to in my local area and they say their daughters have been groomed, yeah, by Muslims and they don't want to come to Sikhi. They don't want anything to do with Sikhi, they don't want anything to do with their parents, completely brainwashed. And the mums or the grandmas always say they never ever taught them about Sikhi. They never taught them about Sikhi. And one of the main questions that Musliman will say to girls, young girls, is, did you know that Guru Nanak was a Muslim, really? Because only Muslims are allowed in Makkah, and Guru Nanak Dev Ji went there. Everybody knows the Sikhi, you know, and Guru Sahib went there, and he said, move my feet, because he was facing the Kaaba. So because only Sikhs are allowed, only Muslims are allowed there, and he went there, that makes him a Muslim. And because the girl, or the boy, it might be a boy, is so uneducated about Sikhi, they will believe that. And then we'll think, oh, it's not that much difference if I have a relationship with this person, he's the same as me, technology. In the past, when I was talking to my mum yesterday about this talk, I said to her, why did you never teach me about Sikhi? Why? And she said, because I come here first generation, and my main focus was to get a house, and to keep a job, and to keep you guys in school, and do this, and do that, and I never had time for Sikhi. Is that an excuse? I'm not going to be hard on parents who have lived that life, because I wasn't there. But I do see people that came first generation who have still kept Sikhi alive with their children. A lot of Sikhs came to this country and said, I had to cut my hair, I had to cut my beard, yeah, because I had to get a job. But I've seen lots of Sikhs who came to this country and they never cut their hair, never kept. So really, for some, it's about willpower or what you think that you can have, what you can achieve. It's about how much faith you have in Guru. So Mum said to me yesterday, but Bade vaste bahut easy hai. You've got so much on your side, you've got technology on your side. Yeah? We've got so much technology, and that's why I put up there, there's apps now, Gurbani apps, yeah? There's online Sikhi stories. Even I'm saying to you, spend time with your children and tell them a story. If still you don't have time to find time for your children, there's a Sikhi app called SikhNet Stories. It's a £2.69 that you buy from the app store on your smartphone or your iPad. And when I don't have time, and I'll be honest, I don't always have time. When I don't have time to read her at night time, I'll put the app on and she will listen to a Sikhi about Kaurs and go to sleep. Yeah. So there are there are other, and also you've got Sikh channel now that is bringing us, you know, day-to-day coverage of what's happening back home, yeah, if we want to call it that. So there's lots of things on our side. In the past, they didn't have these things. But now you can communicate very easily. Most of you people would have heard about this program through Facebook. And like Benji said, Kaurs Corner have a very, very, very strong presence on social media. There's no excuse for not being able to get in touch in any kind of way with questions or when next programs are or anything. And we're lucky about that, we're lucky. And then, like I said, the Sikhi films, Sangat I mentioned, take your children to the camps, take them to Gurmukh classes, take them to Sandhya, take them to Gutka. You take them swimming, you take them to tutor, yeah? You take them to the barbers, you find time for all of these things, find time to bring them to the Gurdwara and expose them to Sikhi. Camps. And then I'm very conscious about what I expose my child to and what I shield my child to. Some people say I shield my child from too much. I don't care. I'd rather shield them and then teach them. If you open everything up to your child straight away, it's very hard to close that down. If you shield your child, you can release little bits to your child. My child has never ever been to a meeting Shadar party ever in her life. She's 6 years old, Maj Gripa. She's never been around anyone who's drank Shadar either. Like, she's never been somewhere and someone's got a bottle there or something. When I say that, I mean like a Punjabi, like say like my dad or like a relative of ours. Because if a Gora's doing it, because some people say to me, because I don't go in places like that as well, and people say to me, maybe some of you are thinking it right now, but you know, how can you hide away from these things in the world? Who's thinking that? Can you hide away from these things in the world? Because everybody drinks, everybody eats meat, everybody does smokes, yeah? But the thing is, one thing I can always, always say to my child is that person's not Sikh. But if my child sees someone wearing a dastar, yeah, or my child sees her granddad or her grandma or something doing something like that, it's harder for me to explain that. I don't tell her, she knows that they do it, but seeing something with your eyes is very hard to take away from the mind, I find. So I'm very, very conscious about what I expose her to and what I shield her from. Then language. Never swear in front of my child. I never, ever use bad language. I never, ever use, I think it's disgusting. I was in Asda the other day. If people follow me on Facebook, they would have seen it. And this woman, she said to her child must have been about 6 years old, and she only shouted at him because he wasn't keeping up with her. And she said to him, keep the up with me. She used the F word. That 6 year old, that is a normal word for that 6 year old right then and there. Normal word, everyday word. I see it so much. Gore bored goddamn. Really, really a lot. Gore talk like really bad language. But it's not just about swearing. I'm talking about Punjabi swearing as well. That's worse. Yeah? It's so filthy. Oh, it really makes my blood boil. Because I think to myself, if you wanted to have a child, what is the point in having having that child and then filling their mind with such filth? So it's not just about swearing, it's about the way you talk to your child. It's the way you talk to your child. I'm not saying don't do jibga, you have to do jibga sometimes. But sometimes, so someone said in the crowd, we want our child to be respectful. But your child will not be respectful unless you are respectful to your child. Because they will mimic what you do, and that's what I wanted to read to you. A Guru Sikh wrote on Facebook yesterday, and I just come across it, just a janak. And I thought, oh, I'm going to save that to read. So be careful about what you expose your child to, which means you have to be careful about what you are doing. Yeah? Because if you're going to my best friend, she is keeping her children's hair, but she's got very short hair. She said to me, we went to a picnic the other day, and she said, I don't tell them that I go to the barbers anymore, go to the hairdressers anymore. I said, oh yeah, why is that? She said, because the other day he said, Mummy, why do I have a budga and you go to the hairdressers? I thought she was going to cut their hair. She said, I didn't have a leg to stand on. I didn't have one leg to stand on. And then she said, I tried to say to him, you're a boy and I'm a girl. And she said, but he said, but Penji said we're equal. So does that mean that you've got to keep your hair too? She said, I didn't know what to say to him. She goes, I decided that I'm just not going to tell him that I go anymore. But he's made me realize I have to calm down on what I'm doing, because whatever I'm doing, he's watching me all the time. And this is what this verse wrote. Children will emulate their parents. The parents' attitude to Sikhi is the benchmark the child will base their behavior on. If parents chat away in their rasa, so too will the children. If parents absorb themselves in the shabad, so too will the children. Children will mimic the body language they pick up on. Bored parents, bored children. That is so true. Your child will become you. And you know, like me and Benji were saying, I don't want to become my mum. And she was saying, I don't want to become my mum. And as we said, we only want to become the good parts of our mum. Yeah? So I only want my child to become the good parts of me. But my child will automatically pick up the bad parts of me unless I try to think about what I'm doing all the time and how I'm acting, because naturally my child can't control what she picks up from me. She can't, she's too young. So what we have in our house is we have something called table time. Basically, I had it when I was growing up, and so I've introduced it in our household. If there's a problem in the house, she's 6 years old, but if she has a problem, we have to have a family meeting, and her say has to be heard, and then we have to discuss it. Even if someone walks away saying, I don't agree, or I agree, or something like that, everybody has to feel like their voice is heard in the household, and we do that all the time. Well, whenever someone needs to call a meeting. And you know what? It makes the child feel like I am a part of this family, and I'm not being dictated to. I'm not being told what to do all the time. I'm making the decisions in this house as well. And your child will feel more, I hope, closer to us as a family. Anyway, moving on. And then discipline. I went to an entivay a while ago, and I was in the langar hall with my baby and my daughter. And my daughter was being really naughty. She was running around. She gets jumbly when there's other children around. She was running around going crazy. She normally doesn't act like that. So I knew that she was getting carried away with the children. So I gave her first warning. Oh, I had a Purusik sitting here. I had a Purusik sitting here, and I had a Purusik wife sitting here. Yeah, and we were eating our food, and she ran past like this. Her jawline, her pajamas was like this, and it's all getting black from the langar hall and everything. I was getting, her pan was going everywhere. It's not really how we should teach our children to act if they're dressed that way. And I said to her, Munsimut, this is your first warning, you need to stop. I said it in front of everybody. Everybody heard me, everybody was probably looking at me thinking I'm a terrible mother and shouting at her in front of everyone. My husband doesn't like it when I shout at her in front of other people. His mum used to do that to him. He doesn't like it when I do that to her. But she was being naughty at the time, I had to stop it at the time. She said, okay mummy, carried on. She was fine, carried on going. A couple of minutes later, she's doing the same thing, gave her another warning. Next time, then I said to her, come and sit down here. We have a tally system at home. She's only allowed to have 3 tallies in a day, 8 tallies in a week, and then we reward her or we punish her accordingly. I said to her, that's it, you've got a tally. The Gursik next to me, he said, I go all over Europe, and he goes, what I see with Gursik parents is they don't discipline their children because they're so scared that if I discipline my child will not want Sikhi. And he goes, I think it's really good that you're disciplining your child, that you've got this tally system. And I said, I'm not doing it for any other reason but my own sanity. Because if I don't discipline the child, the child will never learn. At the same time, it's not me telling the child off all the time. She knows if I do something wrong, she can come and tell me. Like the other day, my youngest one, she was really crying, and I said to her, she doesn't know about Jibga, and I said to her, Gudli, stop it now, please, like that. And she came over to me and she said, Mummy, too rough with her. But even though I wasn't really being rough, but in her mind, she, you know, it was for her, it was too rough. But she's had the example set to her that she can come and say that to me, and I'm glad. And I say that to her, you can tell me when I'm doing something wrong, and I will tell you when you're doing something wrong, and that's how we learn from each other. Because sometimes we don't see what we're doing wrong. But nowadays, what it is that there's this one way kind of what happened in my house, when I got older, when I was younger, we had the kind of table setting where we talked about things. When I got older, it changed. What would happen was that the parents were older, more experienced in life, therefore they knew more. But that's not always true. We need to be able to, and I think maybe someone here said that in the beginning, We need to be able to have a two-way relationship with our child. When we listen to our child and our child listens to us, we respect our child and our child will respect us. If we always dictate to our child will learn to resent us. Maybe. So, these are... So these are the things that I wanted to share with you about everyday life that I have with my child. And some of you might find it helpful, some of you might find it not. But the next probably thing you're saying is, she's saying all this stuff, but what happens if her child doesn't become Sikh? And I'm well aware of that, yeah? So I'm well aware, but what if my child does not choose Sikhi? I'm doing all this, I'm putting all this effort in, but what if it's all to waste? Well, first of all, when it comes to Sikhi, nothing's to waste. Nothing goes to waste. Something always goes somewhere. And the second thing is, what I like to do is, when I was saying to you, measure the implementation you're putting in place. Measure. If you're putting a discipline, like I've got the tally system at home, I discussed with my husband, I said, she has started to say please and thank you a lot. She's working. I noticed she did, when we went here, she didn't do that. She's got this thing, she can't sit at the, is anyone else's children can't sit at a table and eat their dinner straight? And then eventually she's on the floor. Like this. And it drives me crazy, because then when we go to someone else's house, yeah, it looks so rude, like she doesn't know how to sit on the table. And I know she started sitting on the table correctly, because every time she didn't sit still, she gets a tally. So that's one way that I measured it. Another way is Raj Benji, she's got a daughter, just 1 year older than Simmer. When they spend time together, yeah, when they talk about Sikhi, I'm listening. Yeah, I'm listening to what they're saying to each other, and it's amazing. Because their conversations are actually so deep. Yeah, the things that they talk about, I'm to stay with us one weekend, and she said something about, we were outside in the garden, and she said something about Guruji's inside all the animals and things like that, which means that when we're talking to our children and teaching them these things, it's going inside, because then they're sharing it with their peers, yeah? And so that's a way to measure, yeah, the conversations that they're having. They still talk about, you know, loads of fireball stuff as well, like, I don't know, Shopkins and things like that. Don't know these things that they're into. But when it comes to the snippets of Sikhi that they talk about, is powerful, because, and that's a way to kind of measure. Then the hardest thing is that we have to be prepared to accept the will of God. That we have to understand our pre-written destiny. So when we come here, everything's written for us. Who's going to become sick and who's not? I don't think in a million years my mum, Raj's mum, Vijay Singh's mum ever thought that we would be like, you know, dressed like this and take our mouth and things like that. Like, you know, didn't think in a million years, you know. But I have prepared myself that there may be a chance that it's not in my child's destiny to become Guru Sikh. But does that mean I stop trying? No, because the thing about Guru Sahib is that he created this system called Deshi system, where you can go to the Guru, you can have an audience with the Guru at any time, ask the Guru any questions. So if my child was to decide that no, Sikhi's not for me, and goes and cuts her hair, eats meat, starts to drink, do all these things, but then one day decides that she wants to have an audience with the Guru and she wants to come this way, I have given my child all the tools I was meant to give. She will know her Nithinen. She will know the Amritvela. She will know the Ved Mariyada. She will know, you know, what part is done when. She will know how to play the Vajja, how to play the Tabla, how to do Gatka. She will have all these things ready on hand if she was to decide. Exposure to Sikhi that you have yourself as a mother, as parents, you have the ability to change the destiny of your child and yourself. Yeah. And you could kind of make a difference in your child's life. Yeah. But it's not easy, yeah? It's not easy being a parent, yeah? But what I can guarantee you is if your child is is coming towards Sikhi, especially mothers of girls, your child will less likely want to live a life of promiscuity, yeah? So be sexually active. Your child will less likely go into grooming, yeah? Your child, be groomed, sorry. Your child will less likely want to drink, Yeah? Does that mean that these things won't cross that child's mind because they're going to be exposed to it all the time? But one thing that's always going to really bring them back is Gursa. Because they'll automatically, that mechanical Sikhi that I was talking about, that mechanical Sikhi will eventually turn into Maharaj's Gurupa, Pyar for Sikhi, and Pyar for Guru. Yeah? And so that's what we all hope for. And this is one thing that I always say when people ask me, because people love to ask me this question because they think I'm too strict with my child or whatever they think, is I'm always prepared that if she is not going to go the path that I want her to go, that I'm going to be, I know how I'm going to react at the time. I don't believe that disowning your child achieves anything, first of all. If you want to be a good parent, don't ever think that you can disown your child. Otherwise, don't bother going through 9 months. Don't bother going through 20 hours of labor. Don't bother doing that if you're going to say to them, you didn't do what I wanted, so that, you know, I don't want to know you anymore. These things shouldn't come into your mind as a parent. You shouldn't think, I want to disown my child, yeah? What I will say is, if my child was to decide that she wants to get married and have a big blowout reception and this and that, I won't be there. I wouldn't be there. But it doesn't mean that I don't love that child. It doesn't mean I won't be there for that child when that child needs me. But I'm not going to change my principles because my child, who is now an adult, has decided that they want to take a different route. These are all words at the moment. Only Kurusav knows how I'm going to react at that time. Yeah? And maybe if my Sikhi is strong, I'll be able to cope with it. But there's lots of Gurusikhs that I know, really, I say, Brahmgyani. Yeah? Like really high level of spirituality, and their children have not followed Sikhi. But they are so spiritually enlightened that they accept the will of God. I am very far from there. But they are role models for me of how I should be. They haven't decided their children, but they, you know, deal with it however best they can. But that doesn't mean we should be looking at, that might not happen, so why should I go to all this effort? But if you want to raise a child that is going to be successful, respectful, good to humankind, all the things that you've mentioned, role models, you can't expect to raise a Sikh child and then not give them the Sikhi, because then there's no point. Raise an atheist. I'd rather say that to you. Raise an atheist. Don't teach them about religion. Let them decide whatever religion they want to be. But don't say, I'm raising a Sikh child, and then don't expose them to any Sikhi, because that is just, doesn't make any sense. Yeah? And I've probably made loads of mistakes. Please forgive me. Everything that I've said is just from my own experiences. And just kind of, you know, Guru Sahib teaching me, and anything I've said wrong, please don't take it offensive. And if anybody's got any questions, then you can ask me, and I'll try my best. We all can try our best to answer any questions that you might have. Can I just say one thing? It just came into my mind, sorry. 2 years ago, there's a camp called Kaurs Camp that happens once a year. It's a residential camp that happens away. You literally leave your life behind and you go and live for 1 week with Gursikhs and Maharaj. You get up in the morning, you live like an Amritdhari for the whole week, yeah? And 2 years ago I went there, and there was a husband and a wife there. The wife was about 8 months pregnant, and she had come there, and my husband knew her from before he became Sikh, before he converted to Sikhi. And so he started talking to her, and then I started talking to her, and I said, how come you come here? She doesn't wear the star, she doesn't live like a Sikh or anything like that. And I said to her, how come you come here? And she said, because we're pregnant, we wanted to learn more about Sikhi, because obviously we're going to have a child now. Isn't that amazing? She come all, you know, she's given up 1 week of her life, she's 8 months pregnant. I know how uncomfortable it is being 8 months pregnant, and it was hot there, and you're not in your own bed. And she'd come there, she said, we're just here to learn. And she had every workshop she went to, every lecture she went to, every Q&A, she had a notebook with her and she was taking notes. She said, I'm here to learn about Sikhi for my child so I can teach my child. And I found that so inspirational. Don't you think that's really inspirational? Who would do that? And I saw her 6 months after that. She came, because obviously she's originally locally from where we are. And she had come to a wedding, and I was leaving the Gurdwara. And I saw her, and I went up to her and I was like, where's the little one? And she said the little one died at birth. Mm. And I said, I don't know what to say to her. And I said, so you didn't come to Kaurs camp for yourself, did you? As for your child, you come for yourself. She said, yeah, that's what me and my husband always think to ourselves. And she said, she was a little girl. And I could speak to myself that, you know, people, Kurusav's got like amazing plans for us. We just have to trust in it. And I just wanted to share that because I thought it was such an amazing thing that she did for her child.
What was it, a one in America, is it?
No, it's one here. It's like a lodgings. It's really beautiful. It's on a lake. It's very relaxing. You can do activities there. It's really beautiful. There was other complications which I don't want to share anyway, but that I just wanted to share that with you, that how lucky we are. Take it one way. She sacrificed her time to come and learn about Sikhi for her child. She didn't end up mothering that child the way she expected to. And some of us are given that gift to mother a child, but then we waste it. Because when we have children, as Sikhs, the child, and I heard this from Vijay Singh, that when Guru Sahib sends us a soul, a child, to a Sikh family, that child is meant to be, Guru Sahib has sent that child there because the child is meant to be raised as a Guru Sikh. Guru Sahib wants to see that soul raised in that way. Yeah? So if we don't do that, we're causing sin and punishment upon ourselves anyway. Yeah? But another thing I heard from another Guru Sikh, by Manvi Singh, who comes here quite often, he said once to me, he said, you will find that children who are following Sikhi are less likely to put their parents in old people's homes, and are more likely to do seva for their parents, and things like that. And I think that's really true. Because I could never imagine doing, like, you know, leaving my child, not looking after my parents or my husband's parents, you know, because that's a duty that I have as a Guru Sikh. Whereas someone who doesn't follow that line may not think that way. So that's all I wanted to say. If anybody has anything to add, if I have anything to add. Does anybody have anything to add? I hope you find it helpful. Does anybody have any questions?
Is it like more easier for kids to be in Sikhism if the parents are there, especially when they don't cut their hair? The parents can be a role model for the child, so child obeys more, but the parents are cutting their hair. So
it certainly will confuse a child. I've got people in my own family who have kept their children's hair. They don't have hair themselves, and they drink and eat meat and go to parties and do all sorts of things. And when I see that, I think to myself that there's two ways that you can look at it. You can either try and saturate the child with Sikhi, yeah, and basically, but then you need to also be very prepared for that child to turn around and say, like my best friend who I was talking about, the child to turn around and say, well, why should I keep my hair? You haven't kept yours. Yeah, you have to be prepared for that. So you need to be able to say to your child, but think about our principle. Where has society's principles gone full stop now? No, we're all very quick to judge each other, but no one looks at themselves and thinks to themselves, what am I doing? Yeah? So, but I personally think a lot of the world's ills will be gone when we start to think to ourselves, I want to change myself first and then I'm going to change the world. But people are very quick to jump on Facebook and judge this person and make an assumption here and there. But they don't think about themselves. And the same thing happens with our children. So we need to try and change ourselves. And you know what? If you are the kind of person, gears is a really big deal for women. Yeah? It was one of the one things that kept me, held me back from Sikhi, taking that step. Yeah? And there's no harm in saying to your child, we're doing this together. We're doing Sikhi together. But then you need to be able to know that you're in your conscience that you are trying to do it, that you are aiming to not cut your hair anymore, not to go take your child to barbers anymore, to grow your eyebrows or legs hair or whatever. But don't do it as an excuse to say to your child, we're doing it together. Because it's becoming, isn't it? But if you are willing to kind of really say to yourself, you know what, Gurusab, I really want to follow your path, I'm really finding it hard at the time, I want to raise my child as a Sikh, So, you know, help me, use this child as a way to help me. Whether I'm teaching the child or teach myself at the same time, and do it together. Basically, we've got some rules. We set the rules when I was pregnant. So no sharab, no meat allowed in the house when we are coming. We don't go to any function where that's going to be. My mum and dad were very agreeing to that. And in doing, they have cut down on eating meat. My dad has cut down on drinking so much that he can't, apparently, my sister was telling me, he can't even handle one glass anymore. That's how he's just not susceptible to it anymore. And I've started to tell my daughter now that they do these things, because I never told her before, but I've slowly started to tell her that they do these things. And more I've met, my dad started doing baths now himself. He stopped cutting his dadi, he stopped dyeing his dadi. So actually it took a positive turn. There's still lots of things that we don't agree on, but I'm the mother. My mum is not the mother of my children, I'm the mother, and I make the decisions about my child. Like my mum made the decisions about me, I make the decisions about my child, and I'm very clear about that. And one thing my parents and my family knows is I will compromise on anything, but I won't compromise on Sikhi, nothing. My sister's getting married in 1 month. Everybody's trying to convince me to go to the wedding reception and the Chura night and this night and that night, and I've said no, because I am not compromising my principles for nobody. And like I said to you, I wouldn't even do it for my own daughter if she decided she wanted to have a certain type of wedding. I wouldn't even do it for her. So, and for me, I feel like I would rather have them be upset with me than my guru be upset with me. So it's about weighing what's important to you.
I mean, it doesn't apply to me, but I'm just general about them. It's easier to convince your own parents, like a girl can convince her son. But it's normally difficult for the ladies to convince their in-laws' parents. Like their in-laws, like a husband's parents, I would say.
Yeah.
And I think that ladies are finding a lot more problem convincing them rather than their own parents. Mm. And with your parents, you can take a step, that's fine. They have to, yes or no, that's it. But with in-laws, you have to be put up with a lot of things.
I agree with that. And what I would say to that, first of all, is it's about trying to bring your husband on side first. So if you've got your husband, so I think that my in-laws are Amrithari. When I say Amrithari, I mean like they kind of like pick and choose. But generally, they will agree with everything we say because they're kind of doing most of it anyway. They don't have egg in the house, no meat, no sharab. Mm-hmm. So they agree with all these things. So in that way, I'm okay. I'll just give an example because I don't know. But say for example, if Raj's in-laws are not into Sikhi, mm-hmm. and she's got these rules, I think she's got a stronger case to fight if her husband is on side. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when we're coming into Sikhi and we're following this path, there's certain things that we won't be able to do straight away, but sometimes it's about kind of focusing on the immediate family. So that means that your children and your husband at first. Yeah, and once you guys are strong as a unit together, then you can tackle the world. That's how I feel, but I mean, I might be wrong.
No.
Because if you've got your husband on the side, then your husband can speak for you when it comes to your in-laws. So, I don't know.
What if you want to keep your children to Sikhi and your other half doesn't want to? It's not like he doesn't want to, but you know, sometimes there are certain rules you make. Sometimes if your partner finds hard to follow them instead of your children to follow. I mean, it is something as a mother, as a Kaurs partner, I just want to know what are the set of rules you can do it. Not telling, not making a different kind of environment at home. For example, you want them to do it. It's quite confusing for kids.
Yeah.
It's okay for me, for other people to watch or to play games or to watch football matches. I mean, lots of find it difficult. And the only woman bringing them here for the Sikhi classes, for the Punjabi classes. But I find it most of the time on Saturday, on Sunday, whenever we make these classes together,
most of the time women bring it, and moms bring it, not the fathers. With the girls it's okay. With the boys sometimes it will become hard because they follow a man, they follow dad. So what should we as a mothers do?
First of all,
especially with the playing games, they want outside.
With the
boys, they want to play outside, they want to play football. I'm not a good player. I can teach them stories, I can teach them softies. But what to do with that side so that they can be in Sikhi as well when they are doing it?
That's a good question, hard question. One thing I will say is that the child's first sangat is always the mother, because the mother holds the child for 9 months or 10 months, should I say. So we need to be prepared that as women, our job is never done. You can go to sleep. I always say that to my husband. He goes, come to bed. No, I need to do this, I need to do this, I need to do this. You can go to sleep. But the thing is, I accept that is how God has made. Because I can work for 10 hours straight and then go and go home and make the roti, then do the washing, then get the kids to sleep, do their sicky stuff, whatever, blah, 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 homework, and then do whatever I need to do in my own time and still be standing. My husband, after 10 hours, needs to go to sleep. Because man is not built that way. Women can take so much. So I think we need to accept that certain things we are always going to have to take up. When it comes to the children, we are always, you know, we're lucky if we've got very, very active partners who kind of like are willing to share the load. As for the question that you asked about how the boys, I don't know if Barbie's got a suggestion.
I was just going to say that football kid does not get sick. So if you do not even see an academic to pass and they're try to educate them about Sikhi, but all that they're not supposed to be. But as long as the dads are teaching them anti movement things, as long as they're playing football, they're going to be able to get that school anyway. So it was for Dila Dunya, but you know, that's good. So then whatever time your mother can spend with her children, then she can share sakya, that's very good. And then the child will learn a lot more. The child learns a lot more from the mother than the father, rather than if it's a boy or a girl. So therefore, that sakya that you give your child, then that will have an impact on the character of the child as well. And then you maybe get in our mind that she, when I taught her, before she eats, she has to say that. But my dad, who's grown now, they like sari khan pi wale, party kar wale. My dad was about to eat something, and this is about 2 years ago when she was five, she stopped him. She goes, "You haven't done as das yet." And I've got a video on my phone where she's telling him, she's saying and then he repeats after her. And this is what's happening more now. If we can feel that spirit, do not even discuss something, if we feel that spirit into our children, then they're going to be teaching their grandparents and stuff like that about Sikhi. They're going to be the ones who bring their grandparents to Sikhi.
I think to start off with, a good idea is like Bud mentioned, the little things that you can implement. So, like I said, the adas before the card starts. And then explaining why we're doing our task, we're invoking Waiguru and saying to Waiguru, please can you protect us on this journey? Yeah? Teach your child a little adas before food? Yeah? And do it together. And then you could do one thing that's really important is sitting together and eating dinner. That's really, really important to sit down and eat as a family together. Nobody does that anymore, sit in front of the TV.
Yeah.
Or everybody eats separate. This is really bad. We should sit down and we always sit down at the table together, we try to, and we always say, Mansima, what did you do at school today? She has to tell us three things that she did different at school. Then my husband has to say what he did today. She doesn't understand anything that he says, but it's like something practice that we started. That's the time we're spending together as a family, yeah? And another thing that we do is, when we're like bored, we're in the car or you know, we're doing shopping. She gets really bored when doing shopping, or I try to distract her because then she wants to pick up any little thing. What I say to her is I say, I test her. So I say, who was the sixth guru? Who told us that we had to have a bunch of God? Yeah. Who was the Bibi who changed the minds of the Jalimukhya? I ask her these questions, I test her. And every time I'm trying to get harder and harder and harder, because I want to know if what I'm teaching her is going in. These are tiny little things that you can do with your children. You might think it's not that much in our fourth Bibi we have, but those little things could have such an impact, because one, for a boy, yeah, one story about, like, you know, you could tell, like, Bhagavad Singh, yeah, you could tell a story about him, yeah. With a boy, they love these things, and they're like, they want to hear, oh, I want to hear these fighting stories. And they thought, and then the key to when they get a little bit of enthusiasm is that you say, you know something, that was a real man. Superman is not real, but this was a real man. And he was a Sikh. And he's like your ancestor. And, you know, and then get your child excited about their history, and they will want to learn by themselves. There's so many comics now as well. Gurudev Bahadurji comic there is, Baba Bandha Singh Bahadur comic there is, and really nicely done. They're properly done, like Superman comics and everything, Marvel comics, and they've made them. They've really
read the literature as well. It's quite not at least 7-year-old, 6-year. I have those books.
Yeah.
I have me and my husband read it first before you get it. But the language they use is quite like for 11.
But you have to change that,
yeah,
because unfortunately we, like I said, we're, yeah, as a board with Jehogi, if you go into Waterstones, yeah, under reference in kids section, there is a book on every single religion except for Sikhi, right? And we don't even have a book in Waterstones on Sikhi, yeah? So what we do is we've got loads of Sikhi books, but I change it. There's loads of mistakes in ours as well. They've got pictures of in one book that we've got. They've got a picture of who is it? Mother Bhagor, and she's got like a tikka and this and that, and like she looks like a mix between a Hindu and a Sikh. And I say to her, this is wrong. Don't be scared to say to your child, this is wrong. Someone's done this wrong.
That's what we do.
Sometimes it's about you doing research, and you have to read it yourself, and then you have to change it accordingly, because his history might be wrong in some places, unfortunately. But I think there are some books that are coming out soon that are going to be a bit more accurate, I think, anyway. Yeah. Anybody else got any questions? Thank you very much. Why did you go past?
Why did you?